Good morning and hello everyone. Bienvenue, Akitiushikin, Tanzi, and Anin. My name is Jane Curtis. I'm CEO of Southern Health-Santé Sud, and it's my distinct pleasure to welcome you all here this morning. Together, we acknowledge that Southern Health-Santé Sud is located on the original lands of Treaty 1 and Treaty 3 territory and on the homelands of the Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on these territories and acknowledge the harms and mistakes of the past, specifically the legacy of the residential schools. In solemn joint mourning for the lives of the many children found across our country and the potential for others to be discovered, Southern Health-Santé Sud affirms our commitment in responding to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission of Canada Calls to Action 18 to 24. As an organization, we aim to embrace the distinct cultural knowledge, practices, and traditions of the Indigenous people, and to continue our efforts to strengthen relationships with the Indigenous communities and the peoples whom we serve. I would like to acknowledge you all here today as we welcome our provincial partners for a very important and exciting announcement. And without further ado, I would like to call on the Honourable Kelvin Goertzen, Premier of Manitoba, to the podium.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Steinbach. Members of the media, thank you for coming and joining us here this morning as well. This has been a tough 18 months, and I know that people are tired of hearing that, but it's true, and it's important to acknowledge it. It's also important to acknowledge many other things that are happening in the world beyond the pandemic. And thank you, Jane, for the land acknowledgement. Yesterday, Truth and Reconciliation Day, was really pleased to see so many local residents wearing their orange shirts. And then in Winnipeg yesterday at the park, to see hundreds of people gather to recognize the importance of the first Truth and Reconciliation Day, and thanks to all of those who participated. Of course, it's most rewarding for me to be here in the city of Steinbach, my home community where I've grown up and continue to live. It is a community that has changed tremendously. For those who haven't been here often or just come sporadically, you'll know that now is the third largest city in Manitoba and continuing to grow. It is remarkable to see that growth, but as I knew when I got elected as an MLA and then in cabinet, and all those who have served in elected office, whether it's Mayor Funk, former Mayor Goertzen, nearby areas of Reeve Stantaves, will know that that growth is good. It is better than the alternative, but it's still a challenge. With growth comes a lot of different pressures, and the community has been responding together with government to those pressures. Very much looking forward to the personal care home at Rest Haven opening in the first quarter of next year, between $30 and $35 million investment. That's important. Recently announced the event center, together with private partners, a $40 million investment in this community that'll better the lives of those who live here. But of course, this is about healthcare. And I want to acknowledge all of those who are working here and in other places in healthcare in the area for their very, very dedicated effort during this pandemic. Not just during the pandemic, but of course, this has been a particularly difficult and challenging time. They have stepped up in ways that I don't even know, that none of us will ever know. Their families have also endured difficulties as their family members have come to work. So it has been an incredible challenge, but they have really stepped up, and I know that many of them are represented here today. And if we don't say thank you enough, we say thank you today, and please know that we continue to thank you. And can we give all those a hand who are here represented to the healthcare community? But we also know that the pandemic isn't the only healthcare challenge that we have. Long before the pandemic started, there were healthcare challenges, and as the health minister for 2.5 years, I remember many of those, and they've continued on through the pandemic, and in some ways they've probably gotten worse. And so we need to continue to look not just to what has to happen today, but what's going to happen past the pandemic. I want to particularly note that we have been working on a clinical plan to look at how do we strengthen the healthcare system, not just in our largest center in Winnipeg, but really across Manitoba. We knew before the pandemic that we needed to have stronger regional centers outside of Winnipeg, that it couldn't just be Winnipeg bearing the load for healthcare. And so the clinical services plan, which began several years ago, is the reason we are here today. It is the reason this announcement is happening. So it is my pleasure to announce it as part of that clinical plan and the broader plan from the province of Manitoba to bolster healthcare in the city of Winnipeg, but beyond the city of Winnipeg. We are announcing a $32 million expansion and renovation of the Bethesda Regional Healthcare Centre. That will ensure that this centre becomes and continues to be the district regional hub, and the many, many services that otherwise might take place in Winnipeg, people will be able to get some of those services here. The $32 million expansion and investment will add 23 acute care medicine beds and ensure that we have additional support and for surgical capacity. Additionally, there'll be support for palliative and end of life care, cardiopulmonary disease, and women's health. There'll be pharmacy upgrades to ensure that the cancer care center here continues to be the regional hub for cancer care surgery. And there's a long-awaited establishment of the renal care services, the new dialysis center here in this region, which will go to tender, I understand, later this year and begin construction early next year. And I know that there are many, many people who have lobbied for that to happen over a number of years. So this is an important day, but it doesn't happen without partnerships. It's true for the personal care home, it's true for the event center, and it's true here today. We need other partners, and the Bethesda Foundation has been an amazing partner to ensure that these projects happen. They're always advocating, they're always supporting, and I know, and Garth will say, I'm sure, that they're the foundation, they're the front piece of the support, but behind them are all the people who are giving of their funds, of their time, donating to the foundation to make sure that projects like this can happen. It's the nature of this community. Steinbach and the southern part of Manitoba is a generous and caring part of Manitoba. They care for their neighbors, they care for their communities, and they've long been a leader in giving in the country and around the world, and that will continue, and it's demonstrated here today. I also want to thank, before I welcome him to the mic, our regional leaders, Stan Taves, the Reeve for the arm of Hanover, and Mayor Earl Funk. In this challenging time, steady leadership is very important. It's been an emotional time over almost 2 years, and it's difficult for leaders to not ride those emotions. We talk about waves when it comes to the pandemic, and I know that we are in the beginning part of a fourth wave, which we are trying to blunt with the measures that we have in place so that we don't look like other areas of Canada. But it's sometimes hard for leaders not to ride those waves as well, those rides of emotion. We all feel that as individuals. But Reeve Stan Taves and Mayor Earl Funk have been steady hands. Reasonable, rational, ensuring that information is being put out in the best way possible. And that has been very, very beneficial to me and to this area. So I want to thank them for their steady hand, because you get tested in many times in leadership, but you don't get the opportunity to decide the times you get to lead. You just get elected to lead, and then the times come along. And they have shown to be great leaders in a difficult time. So with that, I want to welcome to the mic Mayor Earl Funk, the mayor of the city of Steinbach.
Well, thank you very much, Honorable Premier Kelvin Goertzen. And I just want to bring greetings on behalf of the City of Steinbach and Steinbach City Council. It's a great day today in Steinbach to hear these announcements. And you know, announcements like this, they continually make me feel grateful. I feel grateful for the province. Thank you, Honorable Premier Kelvin Goertzen, for the province coming forward with money like this. I feel grateful for the Southern Health. Thank you, Jane Curtis, and your team. I feel grateful for our Bethesda Foundation. Without them, so many of these projects couldn't be done. There was seed money that was given for the personal care home, seed money given for this. It's just incredible to have an organization like that in our community. And the City of Steinbach is just grateful and honored to partner with them. And like Kelvin said, it's about partnerships. And we do love to partner to bring facilities to our community, facilities that we've needed. I'm also very grateful for our healthcare workers. And I thank you so much for being frontline workers in such a hard time as a pandemic like this. And you know, showing up for work every day and just doing your best. And the stories I hear are amazing coming out of our healthcare system. Every time they say, I was in Steinbach, and they were awesome. And that's a testimony to how great the healthcare workers we have. Can we just take a minute now to just give them a hand? Thank you so much for being grateful with me. And we're just looking forward to all these facilities coming. The dialysis is something that we've talked about and we've advocated for a long time. And thank you so much, Premier Goertzen, for listening and hearing those cries and those wants. And you know, you didn't come here to listen to me. You came here for the announcement. But again, I just will say how grateful I am that we can partake today, and how we can have partnerships, and how partnerships are so great. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayor Funk. And now I'm pleased to invite the Reeve of Hanover's Dan Taves to the podium.
Just bear with me here. Good morning. Honorable Premier Kelvin Goertzen, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. As the Reeve of the Rural Municipality of Hanover, I, Stan Taves, would like to thank the organizers of today's event for this invitation. This is indeed great news for southern Manitoba. With the growing populations, there is ever more need. There is certainly a need for hospital beds. The addition of offering dialysis at Bethesda Hospital will make life a lot easier for people that are in need of dialysis here in the southeast. That will save them many hours of travel and also money. There have been many requests in the past. I know Hanover itself has received letters and petitions, and we have forwarded them on to the province, and the province has listened. I also have a personal story where I had a friend of mine who had to have dialysis. I many a time took the day off and took him to Winnipeg. Even from here, it's not that far, but if you're from Vida, it's even further. And he always told me after the dialysis, he was very tired. So then we had to make the trek home. So this is indeed great for these people that are afflicted with these ailments. I also want to thank all the medical staff. They've gone out over and beyond, like we've heard already, and they keep doing this. So thank you again. I'd like to thank the provincial government for seeing the need and investing in expanded health care services in our region. On behalf of the Hanover Council, I thank you again for investing in our region. Thank you.
Thank you. Reeve Taves, and I just want to acknowledge and express my thanks to the province of Manitoba, Manitoba Health and Seniors Care, and our municipal partners who have been on this journey with us along today. Please know that this enhancement will enable better services and quality of care to our citizens of this area and beyond. Thank you to our provincial partners. Dr. Mauro Verrelli is Medical Director of Manitoba Renal and Provincial Medical Specialty Lead of Renal Health Shared Health. I would like to now invite Dr. Verrelli to come forward and share a few words. Dr. Verrelli.
Thank you, Jane. Good morning, everyone. It is a true pleasure, it's an honor and privilege to be here amongst all of you, and in particular representing our patient population, our patients who are in so much need of services, renal services and broader services that I'm so grateful that now can be obtained here in this community locally to serve this population as we move forward. As a frontline health worker, I see the day-to-day tribulations of our kidney patients. Not only do we see people being ill, but then there's this travel that we've heard about. This is a good moment. This is a moment that we've all been looking forward to. This is in line with the clinical and preventative services plan that the province has introduced, and definitely a groundbreaking in that context. I'm very grateful to all the stakeholders, to all the collaborators and partners that have contributed to this. The community, the patients who've been advocating for years, the province, and all of those who've put so much work into this. We have in Manitoba one of the highest rates of kidney disease in the country. Dialysis is certainly important. It's important to deliver it as close to one's community as possible, but we must remember that prevention has to be first. We will continue to strive to ensure that we try to prevent this unfortunate chronic disease. We must keep in mind that transplantation, kidney transplantation, is really the next best thing to dialysis, to having one's own kidney. And dialysis in a in-center environment is certainly important, and it serves a role where people cannot be in their own home to do dialysis. But ideally, what we really want to see is people in their own home, in the comfort of their own home, as much as possible. These services all go hand in hand, and I'm very pleased to see that as we move forward, it is coming together. There's a provincial outlook, and these services are getting integrated, not only in the kidney world, but across all the chronic diseases. We have an aging population. We have diseases that are growing, that are chronic, like diabetes and vascular disease as our population gets older. And we have to do what we need to do to ensure that these services are provided to Manitobans in their local community as much as possible, and obviously for more specialized care in the appropriate centers. I thank you all for being here and having me to represent our patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Verrelli. The Bethesda Foundation has been a committed partner for many generations. Their vision and mission has remained solid and unwavering. They support us by enhancing, enriching, and maintaining a high level of safe, quality care. It's a privilege and a pleasure to work in partnership with the Bethesda Foundation. And now I'd like to call on Mr. Garth Reimer, Bethesda Foundation Board Chair, to speak.
Thank you, Jane. This is a new experience for me. I had some speaking notes prepared for me. I usually do them myself, so if you notice an improvement, that's the reason. I think this is as good as it gets for a day for healthcare in Steinbeck and the surrounding communities that access care here. There's a recognition by the provincial government, shared health, and all the players that this is a growing community that needs enhanced healthcare services almost, I shouldn't say daily, but very regularly. It's not as if you can provide some support to Steinbeck once and done. It's a growing community and it needs that sustained support and growth in healthcare services that are provided here. So I'd like to thank the province and all the leaders and the partners that we connect with for recognizing that. It's very important. At the foundation, we fund enhancements in patient care, innovation, and healthcare capital projects at Bethesda and in the surrounding areas. In the past, we've supported many significant projects like the redeveloped emergency department, the cancer care and obstetrics facility, the crisis stabilization unit, the Bethesda Primary Care Center, Bethesda Wellness Center, mental health initiatives, and our current one we're very proud of is the Rest Haven that's coming to completion. I think the Premier mentioned first quarter. He's maybe knows things about construction that I don't. Maybe he's optimistic, but it's going to be coming soon. We pledged $5.3 million to that project, and we're also at the table with the province in structuring how the transaction would work. We're very pleased with the impact that'll have on the community. It's 143 new beds, 100 jobs, and allow people to have care in the community in which they grew up and pay taxes in, instead of going to other facilities an hour or 2 hours away, which did provide good care, but it wasn't the same as being in your home when you're older. So I mentioned all these projects the Bethesda Foundation has done. As the Premier prompted me to say, that is only possible through the generosity on a sustained basis of members of this community. We're very thankful for that. That's the only reason we can do our job. And in fact, if there's an exciting new project that comes along, we are quite quick at the foundation to make an unconditional written pledge to support it of money, because we know the community will always be there. So I have to always recognize the community for their support. One of the things the Bethesda Foundation also has done, and I think almost I'm the most proud of, is we've maintained in the era of regionalization, amalgamation, consolidation, a fairly large band of people that are local, that are volunteers, that are committed to expanding healthcare in this community. It's an off-balance sheet asset, but it's a big asset for a community to have a core group of people that are still locally concerned about healthcare. They're not only concerned in the sense that they're going to complain, they want to support, they want to advocate, they want to partner with the people they have to partner with. So I think that local board, I can't say enough about it. We have good staff, good executive director, good employees, and a great hardworking board. I want to recognize them whenever I can. I probably don't do it enough. But anyways, today's investment is exactly the type of meaningful projects that we are excited to support. One that will bring more services to our city and our health region and reduce the need for communities or families and loved ones to travel to Winnipeg for care. Thank you very much, Mr. Premier, and our partners for making these projects a reality.
Thank you, Mr. Reimer. At the center of Manitoba's health system transformation is the development of the Manitoba Clinical and Preventative Services Plan. As a region, together with the province and many frontline clinical leaders across the province, we have been privileged to work on this Made in Manitoba plan to deliver better health outcomes. Planning is aligned with principles that will support better patient care and sustainability of the quality of care offered now, but also into the future. This new investment in expanded acute care, inpatient capacity, and renal services will strengthen the network of resources that makes Bethesda Regional Health Centre an important hub of medical services. It will greatly benefit the long-term needs of this growing area with high-quality, specialized care that is closer to home. It's been said already this morning, but I think it bears saying again, I would really like to take a brief moment to salute the work of the healthcare teams at Bethesda and across our region and province for their valuable work in this tremendously challenging time. We want you to know that you are appreciated for all that you do. Thank you. And last but not least, the communities represent the true diversity of our region. They come in all sizes, and they come with different cultures and traditions. I cannot say enough about the community of Steinbach and surrounding area. You have been hardworking, tenacious, unwavering for many generations. Your response for support has been second to none. You are a testimony validating that all good things worthwhile are possible, and that truly good things do happen to vibrant and involved communities. So thank you. So together we look forward to planning in partnership, to breaking ground, and to gathering again when the doors are ready to open. This concludes our formal program, portion of the program today, and I would like to now invite media to source their questions about today's announcement to Premier Goertzen. This will be followed by a photo op. Thank you.
All right, seeing no questions, thanks very much, everybody, for...
Yeah. I mean, we heard a lot about home dialysis from the province a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
Does this addition of the renal unit here signal a pivoting away from home dialysis, or are you hoping people who are currently on home dialysis will do this?
Yeah, I don't think it signals a pivoting away, and I know during my time as health minister, I mean, home dialysis where... it's appropriate for people and it's not appropriate for everyone, and not everybody's comfortable doing it, but where it's appropriate and they're able to do it, it is a great option. But it isn't an option for everyone, either because of their own clinical needs or because, you know, they're not able to find the support to do it at home. So there was a need to have an in-facility dialysis unit, but no, it doesn't move away from the importance of home dialysis where it's appropriate on a clinical basis and a lifestyle basis for that patient.
What's the timeline that we're looking at for this? When are shovels in the ground? When do we expect this?
So when it comes to the dialysis, you know, my understanding is that they're now well into the design function. I believe that they'll tender perhaps later this year, and then they would expect to start construction in spring of next year.
And do you know how many cases from the region that require dialysis?
Yeah, on the travel side, I would leave that to the clinical experts in terms of who's sort of traveling into. They'll get you the information.
Yes.
Thanks, Josh. Question? I don't know that it replaces the vision. I think that there are many different things, you know, in this area where there is a vision for many great things. I think that there was, though, a need for in-facility to have additional support. So, you know, it's the challenge, right, in a community like this where things are growing, that every time you make an announcement, the question is, well, what about the next announcement? That's a good issue to have. But today's announcement will provide additional palliative support in facility, and you know, I look forward, probably not as premier, but I look forward to others being able to make announcements as premier on different issues as they come up, either related to palliative care or otherwise. But I think it's a signal that the province recognizes that the Bethesda Center is the regional center for the Southeast. The Southeast is going to continue to grow. It's going to continue to need more services, and there'll be announcements in the future about other things, I'm sure.
I guess there's perhaps an expectation that we're going to move to more restrictions, perhaps on a regional or a health district or on a vaccination level. What do you make of that?
Look, nobody likes restrictions. Nobody ran as an elected official because they wanted to have any public health restrictions. I'm not going to try to guess how many hours of sleep I've lost either as the former education minister in the first and second wave, or the interim health minister during the third wave, or now the premier in the fourth wave. over restrictions. It is gut-wrenching because none of us want that. But I also have conversations with Jason Kenney in Alberta, and I've had conversations with Scott Moe in Saskatchewan. And I also know we can't get to that place again. We need to do everything we can to ensure that those who need services in Manitoba, whether they're ICU, hospital services, or surgeries, can get those in Manitoba. There are thousands of surgeries that have been delayed as a result of the second and the third wave, and we need to do what we can to blunt the fourth wave. So every decision is based on what's the minimum amount of restrictions you can have to still be able to ensure that people can get those services. So Dr. Roosen and Minister Gordon will be making announcements later today. But again, I know that this is difficult, but I think Manitobans have to understand that we can't get into the situation, or we need to do everything that we possibly can to avoid the situation that we had in the third wave. You know, we're in a relatively good position in Canada right now. Is that a guarantee that we won't have, you know, further difficulties? It's not a guarantee. Nothing's a guarantee in the pandemic. We've all learned that. But we know that if we don't take appropriate actions, we could get into further trouble. So my responsibility as Premier and the responsibility of our ministers is to make sure that we are in the best position to blunt this fourth wave for all of those who need services in every part of the healthcare system, to ensure that our schools can remain open is critically important. We want our houses of worship to remain open. That's critically important. We want our businesses to remain open. That's important. And we want to make sure our healthcare providers can provide healthcare. Those are tough balances to reach, and not everybody's going to agree on how we get there, but we're going to do our best to make sure we get there.
Do you think doing that regional district vaccination, is that the next step?
I think you'll hear more later today. I would say two things, Ian, that when you have restrictions that are specific to vaccination, to proof of vaccination requirements, to some extent they get applied regionally even though they're broad based. So, you know, if for example you have a region that has a 35% vaccination rate and there is a public health order that says you can't have an in-dining experience if you're not vaccinated, well, it disproportionately impacts that area and those businesses, unfortunately, where there's a 35% vaccination rate. So even though it applies broadly across the province, it has a disproportionate effect on those areas. Other regional considerations are recommended by public health, so they'll have more to say about that shortly.
You mentioned your discussions with Kenny and Moe. Have they reached out specifically to Manitoba for aid, for support, whether it's personnel, equipment, or hospital
care? So I spoke to Jason Kenny several days ago just about their situation generally, and you know, I obviously said what we can do, we'd like to do. I think what Manitoba could provide at that time is pharmaceuticals for those patients who are in ICU, so we did ship doses of pharmaceuticals to Alberta for their ICU patients. Where we have the ability to do that or other things, you know, we want to do that. We know that other provinces helped us during the third wave, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and particularly Ontario. I want to thank Ontario for that again. So, and then now I know Alberta is receiving support from the Maritimes. They received some support from us from pharmaceuticals. So that's what a federation does. And I know that, you know, Manitoba would have received some criticism in the third wave. We are a federation. We help each other when we can. We have firefighters that come across into Manitoba to help us. Sometimes we send firefighters to other places. That's part of being part of a country. It's not necessarily a recognition of a failure. We are all in this pandemic together. Today we're in a better place. We want to stay in a better place. So where we can help others. But that's going to mean that there are some things that none of us like that we still have to do. Oh, for sure. So we're not going to do anything that will jeopardize Manitobans or the Manitoba healthcare system. So, you know, the pharmaceutical side made sense. We believed, the healthcare system believed that we had that ability to share that with Alberta. Obviously on ICU beds, even now, and this the morning I believe that there was 19 COVID-related patients in ICU. But there are many other people who are in ICU for other reasons, and we would have been over the baseline number of ICU beds already. So if the baseline ICU beds is 72, I think there would have been closer to 90 people in ICU this morning. So we already know that we're into, you know, a surge mode when it comes to that capacity. So we're not going to do anything that's going to diminish ICU capacity. But again, we do have a responsibility where we can to help other provinces. So pharmaceuticals made sense, and I committed to Premier Kenney that where we could support, we would. So the system overall is looking at hospital capacity, not just from a southern region, but from a provincial region. And this is part of that clinical planning. And, you know, when I was health minister, one of the things that I learned early on is that we have great people working in the system, working in our regional health authorities, but we weren't always connected enough. And that a lot of things were happening in the individual health regions, but there wasn't always a collective view to the province. And Manitoba has some advantages as a province because we have a relatively concentrated population. There's an ability to sort of look regionally on certain things and to bolster the hubs, as that's an announcement that we're having today. So, I mean, we will, as we are into the fourth wave, we have planning that is always going on for contingencies about how we can utilize the beds across the system in the best way possible. There aren't ICU beds in most facilities in Manitoba outside of Winnipeg, of course, but there are beds. And so the system is always planning to be able to use those beds in the best way possible. And today, this announcement, while it won't be here for the fourth wave and the pandemic, I hope will long be a distant and unpleasant memory for all of us when these new 23 beds open. It is a recognition that we are learning from this experience and from previous experiences that we need that capacity to be more broadly spread out. But we will use that broader capacity in the fourth wave where it's possible to use it. Every province has, you know, experienced that. So I think that there's two things that are happening. Obviously, the disruption of the pandemic, and you know, this is important to remember because sometimes we focus specifically on ICU beds, but it's disruptive to the system overall because when you're moving medical staff around to deal with certain hotspots within your system, you're affecting the other parts of that system as well. So every province has dealt with higher wait times in various areas because of the pandemic, because we're moving around staff into different areas. So that's a reality in that there isn't many provinces in Canada who aren't dealing with that. Then the other issue is that there are some people who have just waited to not get medical service during the pandemic. We saw that particularly at the early parts where people were avoiding coming to hospital even though they probably should have had something looked at. And so I think we're seeing a return to more normalized patterns and maybe a little bit more for those who are visiting emergency rooms. That's not a bad thing, but it is disruptive, obviously, in a system where we're moving people around. So it's good that people are seeking medical attention, but every province is facing that challenge. Yeah, I mean, enforcement has never stopped. So, you know, it's the challenge, though, that anything we do with enforcement, you can't have somebody everywhere. So the media is going to be going back to Winnipeg later on, and I'm sure you're all going to drive 100 kilometers an hour on the Trans-Canada, but not everybody will. There are some people who speed on the Trans-Canada, but we can't have a police officer everywhere, and we can't have an enforcement officer everywhere when it comes to the public health orders. But, I mean, you get the reports weekly, I think, on the different enforcement issues that are happening. So enforcement is happening, and it will continue to happen, but, you know, we really are imploring people. I know it's frustrating. I know we're all tired. I know I'm tired of the pandemic. My family's tired of the pandemic. The families around me are tired of the pandemic. But we are in a relatively good place in Manitoba compared to the rest of Canada, and we want to keep it that way. And that relies on enforcement, but we're not going to enforce our way through it. We need people to understand that we want to stay in that place that we're in right now in terms of where we are in the fourth wave. We don't want to get back into a position we were in the third wave. And that relies not just on enforcement, but people understanding that it's important to do the right thing at this point and follow those public health orders.
Are you concerned about the size of the gathering of that St. John's Park yesterday? As we've got this, I heard between 10 and 20,000 people expected to be there. Not a lot of social distancing at best, 50-50 as whether somebody is wearing a mask or not. How concerning is that size?
I suspect that the organizers were probably surprised at the gathering size. So, you know, obviously on the one hand, that's a really good thing. It's great that people recognize that truth and reconciliation, the first day to recognize that is important, that we have a great deal of work to do, and people wanted to show that support. But I suspect that the size of the gathering was probably surprising. So, you know, That's a lesson, and probably had we known that there would be, or had the organizers known there'd be that many people, they might have organized it in a different way. But it's a learning lesson. But you know, the good news is that people recognize the importance of the day and want to show that, and it's a learning experience in terms of organization going forward. Sorry. I don't issue fines, so I don't know what that is. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Thanks again for coming out. I appreciate it. Thanks for all the healthcare staff who've come out and seen it as well. I know many of you as friends and many of you as longtime community members, and we support you, and we know the challenges that you're going through. So thanks you again.